Well, that certainly has got me going. Great music. Thank you, man. Welcome, everybody. It's lovely to see so many new and familiar faces here this evening. I'm Nicole O'Brien. I'm the CEO of Fishburners. And I'd like to start by acknowledging the Gadigal people of the Eora Nation, the traditional custodians of this land, and pay my respects to their elders, both past and present. Welcome to Friday Night Pitches. If you haven't been to Friday Night Pitches before, this is where we're famous for our pitches, and we host them every fortnight, and we welcome you to come and see the amazing founders and entrepreneurs who are doing great things. This evening, we are excited to present three of the founders that just completed the FutureUp program, a key initiative in partnership with the UTS MBA program to inspire, support, and skill up early stage founders to launch and grow a successful business. Fishburners is a not-for-profit enterprise dedicated to helping startups grow. We do this by providing the best facilities, education and learning, mentoring and community of like-minded peers so you and your startup can flourish. Our goal is to make the hardest thing you've ever done easier. Whether you join our physical co-working space here in Sydney or our digital hub, you will be encouraged, supported, inspired and enabled to grow and be successful. If this is something you're interested in exploring further, I encourage you to take time to have a chat with our head of community, Henry Acker, the barman. I'd now like to introduce you to Julia Marchin, a successful entrepreneur and coach extraordinaire from the FutureUp program, to tell you a little bit more about the program and this evening's graduates. Thank you.
Thank you, Nicole. I'll just grab the slider. And so tonight, you're going to have the opportunity to vote for the best pitches. We have a supporting panel. We're not judging them, but we'd like to know from the audience which one you like the best. So the way to vote is to use Slido. Is there anything I need to say? Where's Georgia? No, that's it. Okay, go to slide.do. We'll be reminding you during the pitch. Cool. So what's very important now is to share on social media. So if you do share on for the Twitter guys, that's the at Fishburners or at UTS Engage with Zeus hashtags. And then for the Instagram guys, feel free to do some stories. And I'm going to do one with you guys right now. So I'm going to stand right here. And I want you to start shaking your hand and screaming. So Instagram stories is 15 seconds. Do you think you can do that for 15 seconds? All right, let's do some practice. You ready? Yes! Woo! Come on, come on, 5 seconds, yes! What about the supporting panel? Yay! That's it. So let me add the hashtag. And then done. So if I can do it in that short amount of time, you guys can too, right? And you can win. So that's what you guys can win. Well, I mean, the winner of when you're going to vote for the best pitch, that's what the winner is going to be winning. Cool. Georgia, what did I have to say for this? So the big fish winner will get one more month. Awesome. So a little bit about myself. I'm a part-time lecturer in entrepreneurship at the University of Technology Sydney in the MBA of Entrepreneurship, and I'm a part-time startup coach. And more importantly, I'm a full-time dad. I'm also a big fan of long-distance snorkeling, and you'll see me on LinkedIn giving a lot of startup advice from the beach in my wetsuit. I love that. I also kind of geek out on the Lean Canvas. That's kind of my pet things. I really, really like helping early stage entrepreneurs get the business model together, look at their business on one page. And you'll find my workshop on the Founders Hub at Fishburners. So I was wondering how to introduce the program to you guys this morning when I was in the water. There we go. And so at the moment, I don't know if you've noticed, but the swell is really, really big. And this was scary to me. And it's kind of how we feel as entrepreneurs with COVID at the moment, right? There is that huge wave coming, crashing on the rocks, and we just don't know where to go. And everybody believes that as entrepreneurs, we take crazy risks. We don't take crazy risk. We take crazy calculated risk, right? So usually I go this way, but this was way too scary. But I know that if I go here, there are plenty of opportunities. There are less competition because everyone got scared by that big first wave. They couldn't go over. So we need to find a way as entrepreneurs to assess how we can get there to that happy place where we've got customers, where we've got traction. The way we do that is through usually our entrepreneurial competencies, the business outcome we've developed, our experience in the business, the community, the support that we build around us. And that's what the program here, and to finish, I actually didn't go in the water through here. I walked all the way around. but I did get to the final distance, right? So the program that we've got here is not an accelerator program. It's more like before the accelerator program. And our differentiator is we focus on the founder, not the business, because we believe and we know that investors invest in the person, not the business. And so we help them with a desk and a membership here to have that community that I was talking about. We help them having support with coaching, with group coaching, with mastermind sessions, where we catch up every Monday and we talk about how we're feeling, which was quite important during COVID, but also the challenges and the success that we've been through. We also give them access to 20 modules that we've taken from the MBAE programs. And they build entrepreneurial mindset, entrepreneurial habits. Those habits, when I debrief the first participants, were really, really, the number one was got the habit to talk to and listen to customer on a weekly basis. I think as entrepreneurs, we know this is a number one criteria to start a business, is to really listen to what the customer wants. But it is so easy to go and hide in a corner and build our product without talking to customers. So this program really help the participants to go and build that habit. Build also the habit of reflecting on what happened, what worked, what didn't work. That helps crystallize the learning, like doubling up the learning. And those are just some aspects of what the participants have been learning in that 12-week program that we extended to 14 because of COVID. So we're planning the next cohort, and we'd like to know who is interested, who among yourself feel like early stage entrepreneurs, feel like you need some help to get started. And I was talking to Suzie, who was here tonight, and she was asking me, you know, how did people do it before the program? And I was saying, well, 5% of us can go and build the company on our own, but we can all build a company. But the 95% of us, we just need a little bit of help. And that's what this program is, right? To have a group of like-minded entrepreneurs, to be part of Fishburners, and to get the coaching, to get the modules. So if you're up for it, go on Fishburners website, and there is a tab that says FutureUp, and register your interest. That's as simple as that. So I'd like to introduce the four participants of the FutureUp program the past 3 months. So you'll see on the right inside, Shun and Simon. Shun and Simon had not started nothing of their business when they first started the program, and they had just an idea in mind, and they went out and implemented MVPs after MVPs after MVPs and after MVP, and talked to a lot of customers. You'll see that in the pitch tonight. Then we had Suzie. Suzie had already been part of a pre-accelerator program with CSIRO. She had ideas, she had started to implement, and she went on to talk to more customers and refine her project. And finally, we had Justin. Justin had already been raising his first round of funding. So you can see the diversity of profiles in this cohort that I thought was really interesting. Unfortunately tonight, Simon cannot be here because the reality of starting a business is you still have to pay the bills. So Simon is running a consulting gig at the moment. He's running a workshop. He's helping newspapers go digital at the moment. So he won't be joining us tonight, but we will have Shun, Suzie, and Justin. Before we go and have Johan introduce the MBA in entrepreneurship, I just would like to thank Fishburners and Nicole and Georgia and Henry and the rest of the team, because it's freaking COVID, and here we are all tonight. We still managed to come together. We still, do you know how many places are still closed and we can't meet and we can't have the networking? And I don't know about you, but I miss the networking. I miss hanging out with people. So I just would like to have a big round of applause for the Fishburners team, please. All right, so I would like to introduce Johan Schweitzer from UTS MBAE, who will be part of the panel, and then we'll be introducing Abs afterwards. Thank you. Oh, you've got your mic, yes. I'll give you the clicker.
Test, 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 yeah. Good evening, everyone. So I'm Johan Schweitzer, and do I stand up or do I sit down? All right. And I'm the director for the MBA in Entrepreneurship at the UTS Business School, from which we took most of all of the content and the materials that we use in FutureUp program. So, Julian, just one thing that I wanted to say, it's just amazing how you can go for a swim in the morning and whip up your presentation for the evening. And I don't know how you do that. That's pretty cool.
Productivity.
Yes. So what you see here is it's one of our rooms in the UTS Business School, which is literally closed at the moment, but we're going to open very soon. One of our pitch events, our Venture Day, which usually happens in February. And the MBA in Entrepreneurship, if you just go to the next slide, I just want to quickly share that with you to put this into perspective, is a one-year program that you can knock out in 12 months. With nine key subjects. And what we did here in FutureUp was part of that first autumn subject, opportunity commercialization. About half of that program is what went into the FutureUp program, which is at the beginning of the MBAE, where we're really trying to do what Julian just talked about, starting to create that habit of talking to customers, starting to get into these routines of getting traction with your idea and validating it over and over again. And then you go through the rest of the program and to the end, where we have venture planning and pitching, which is our accelerator program, really, where you were leading up into our venture day, where students can walk away with up to $20,000, $30,000 of award money. So it's a great program. I've been running it for the last 5 years. We had some really amazing students coming through it, and maybe you're one of the next ones. That'll be awesome. Okay, so before I just pass on the microphone to you, Abs, just quickly, my thanks to Fishburners, to the Fishburners team, and also to you, Julian, for running this and sort of, you know, helping these four guys to sort of step up and sort of go the next step.
5 seconds of fame. thanks, Julian. Thanks, Nicole. Pleasure to be back, and I completely agree with you. Missed this networking event. I'm Abhay, part of Singtel Innovate. We are a CVC with a $250 million US fund. We regularly invest in startups. Been working with the ecosystem for the last 4 years in helping, coaching, mentoring, and guiding startups taking to their scale and next level. Happy to be part of the Big Fish game again, and look forward to the pitches tonight.
Excellent. Thank you very much. All right. So we're going to go into the pitches and supporting panel. I really wanted you to be supportive of the people who are going to be pitching. So for some of them, that's going to be the first time pitching in front of a crowd and also being live stream right over there. So please be supportive. This is a safe environment for everyone to learn and to fail in style. So first I'd like to talk about Simon, who is not here, because he's not here, but I was really, really impressed with his ideas. So Simon was a former GM of BuzzFeed Australia with a strong background in journalism. And Simon saw a gap in the market. Simon realized that, remember when we were all checking like how many COVID cases we had and the numbers were like, oh, in Sydney we got that number. And we all realized that to find information about what's happening in our neighborhood, in our zip code, it was really, really hard to find that information. And then during COVID, you may not have noticed, but a lot of local journals closed down. Like, they're not even printing those newspapers anymore. And Simon is right now working on what's going to be their digital strategy from now on. So what he came up with was, and I loved it, he went the full hardcore hustle MVP way. He decided to start his own journal with the community for where he lives, Woolloomooloo. And you know how he went to get his customers? He went to put freaking posters in the street. So you can see the poster. He said, if you want to know what's happening in your neighborhood, just go on this website and sign up. There's 4,000 people living in Woolloomooloo. He got 40 the first week, and at the moment he's got 400 people, so that's 10% of the zip code with an open rate on newsletter of 85%. Don't know about you guys, I run my own newsletter, and if I get 85%, I'll be super happy. This is information generated, news generated by the users, for the users, and kind of curated by Simon, and it's a great initiative. If you guys live in Woolloomooloo, I will recommend to go to woolloomooloo.news and to sign up for that newsletter. And I just want the same in Manly now. My Manly daily just closed down. I just can't even access it anymore. All right, so that was it for Simon. I would like to call, what's his name again? Shun. All right.
Yes, it's Friday, and I can't wait for a glass of wine. I'm going to my mate's place, Jack, and he has no wine at home. So as you do, you go to the local bottle shop, and Jack really has no idea. So he asks the employee for 3 bottles of delicious heavy red. And the gentleman recommends Pinot Noir. Pinot Noir, is that heavy? I'm not sure, but he goes with professional advice. We arrive at Jack's place, and we try the vino. It tastes more like water than wine. I wish there was a fun, easy solution to learn about wine without having making that mistake ever again. Wait, there is. Vino Ed. Vino Ed is a weekly digital wine tasting from the comfort of your own home. Hi, my name's Shun. I've been writing wine lists for your favorite restaurants and hotels across Australia, Hong Kong, and New Zealand for the last 10 years. Let me break down how you join Vino Ed. Step 1, visit VinoWeb's website and choose a wine class. Step 2, 3 bottles of wine get delivered straight to your door. Step 3, Friday night, jump onto Zoom and do a VinoWeb session with me and learn all things wine. How easy is that? At VinoWeb, we are fiercely community driven. From the beginning, we've supported fire-affected Australian wineries. We have partnered with COVID-affected local wine suppliers, and we have collaborated with some of the best entertainers in the industry, like Tim Robarts from Neighbours and Darren McMullen from The Voice. In 2018, 8.5 million Australians enjoyed a glass of wine per week. And in 2020, I'm sure that number's dramatically increased. Vino Ed was launched in the first week of FutureUp. We've completed 10 Vino sessions and 85 people have joined with a repeat rate of 50%. We built an e-commerce website using Squarespace, automated marketing with Autopilot HQ, and integrated Twilio and Delighted with an NPS score of 5 out of 5 stars, baby. Our revenue has been 11,000 so far, and we're building every day. Our business model is simple, 3 bottles of wine, locally sourced and delivered, Friday night live Zoom session with me for the base affordable price of $99. Our team tonight wants everyone in the room and everyone digitally to jump on and text us your email address and join a Vino Ed tonight. And if you join tonight, we'll add in the pack a complimentary, beautiful, delicious bottle of New South Wales wine for your support. Vino Ed was inspired by my love of wine and our team's passion for education and sustainability. Join us on Vino Ed's mission to get Australia walking to a bottle shop confidently. Thank you very much.
Oh,
Love it, man. I love it. It's awesome. God, I love your energy. It's a crazy energy.
Really
good. Congratulations. That was well delivered.
Thank you.
Absolutely cool. And I'm really impressed with what you achieved in such a short amount of time. You got revenue, man. It's amazing.
Yeah, it's been amazing. It's really, really incredible to have support to be able to do that.
But you can't live off it yet.
No, not yet. But soon, hopefully.
So what are you going to do to scale this? What are you going to do? What's in your mind? What do you want to do to bring this, to make this bigger? So yeah. When it goes beyond you, when it goes bigger.
Great question, by the way. So we have wanted to start to do a subscription. But instead of doing a monthly subscription or yearly subscription, we're looking at doing small micro subscription of 12 weeks. So we'll have $49 per week, and you'll get a delivered wine, or you can get all the wine delivered up front. And for 12 weeks, you do a wine subscription through videos and different online platforms. So $49, we believe, after our market research, that we'll get about 1,000 people from that 8.5 million Australians that enjoy wine each week, which will equate to about $49,000 a week. So in the annum, per annum, about $2.5 million. So I'm hoping that will pay the bills.
Not yet. Great to see the concept. I know a few of the ideas that have been floating around, but great to see some execution and runs on the board. I like your slide on collaborations, and just stemming up from there in terms of how would you recruit your audience, and what are your mediums that you're going forward in terms of getting to that 49,000?
So interesting that you say that. I've been fortunate enough to have worked in some of the best restaurants and hotels. So I've met many, many people in celebrity roles or a C-suite already. And because of the connection that you developed with there, they all reached out to me personally. They saw that I was doing this, and they felt like they can add to this new business. And also, they have a personal love of wine. So if I do want to recruit, I want to have people that personally love wine because I feel that sincerity will add a new level of engagement that a lot of other businesses may not see. Does that sort of answer your question?
Sounds good.
So how do you... Sorry, Nicole, your turn. Oh, my God, I'm so excited. So this is really... I'm trying to really figure out and nail what the value proposition is here. Is this to have the Friday night with you and drink a glass of wine and get your advice? Or is this a good deal on a bottle of wine?
I think it's a bit of both, actually. Because I think a lot of people haven't had the opportunity to discover what they like and what they don't like. And having and also have the fear factor of working or going to a restaurant and asking a bartender about wine. So I think it gives people both the opportunities to have a great glass of wine, but also now, even more than ever, I think people want to learn about what's inside the bottle. And they want to learn about, is it organic, is it biodynamic, what the farming practices happened, what is it going to work with? Like, I love fried chicken, what is it going to work with fried chicken? Oh, and I think that's sort of, people want to understand the whole picture now, and I think this is the opportunity to do it.
So I could come to your session, and then next time we have a bottle of wine open at home, I can really show off with some really insider knowledge.
Exactly. And funny enough, I did a vino wed with a corporate client in Brisbane. And they all wanted to learn about how they can better facilitate their dinners and lunches in their corporate crowd. So that is a great option for them as well. So you can impress others, for sure.
Thanks, Shun. I love your shoes, by the way. They're amazing. I think you clearly were all really excited about, you know, what you're doing. Who is the target market?
The target market, I definitely think, is baby boomers and millennials are the ones that I've seen that come on board straight away. The millennial is super thirsty for knowledge, and they want to get everyone to know what's in the glass. And the baby boomer, I think, they don't really want to leave home anymore, and they don't really want to. I shouldn't say that, but they still want to learn because they still want to be able to talk to their kids who are 30 years old about something. So I've really seen a lot of engagement in that area. And also I've noticed the baby boomers, like a lot of them would just drink white wine or just drink red wine. And they've been doing that for 30 years. But because they've been put in this position, they're watching Vino Ed, and they try a bottle of red, and they're like, actually, you know what? I'm now a certain age, and I love red. So I think it's that new discovery piece, which I think has been amazing with each of those areas.
Yeah. Fantastic. Thank you. I love the fact, too, that you're looking at environmental sustainability and you know, how you've got that social enterprise aspect to what you're doing as well, so congratulations.
No, really thank you very much. No, I think sustainability is incredibly important, and wine, yes, one or two glasses are healthy, so I think I want to be able to incorporate both those so you can have a lifelong journey enjoyment with it instead of having a 6 month or a couple of years and I think causing problems.
All right, thank you so much, Shun. I'm going to leave the screen here so you can all text that number because, yeah, that's right. So the way to get the free one is to text your number there and to start booking a wine class with him. And I don't know if you got it, but I got it the second time around. I booked for the session, got the three bottles of wine delivered for the cost of what it will be in the bottle shop, and I got delivered by Shun, which was pretty amazing. And then on Friday night, I was chilling with my wife and my kids, and we just got entertainment at the same time. I'm like, man, I need more startups like this in my cohort. So yeah, just do that, man. Like it's such a great experience. I recommend it. And look how happy I look on the picture. All right, so I'd like to call us Suzie. Come on. All right, be super supportive. Suzie is doing an amazing project, and I think we really need her business in our life.
We won't be clapping after my pitch, but we'll all need a glass of wine after my pitch. Okay. So, do you know how over 20% of domestic violence orders are breached? This is Hannah, Aaliyah, Liana, and Trey. And they all lost their life as a result of domestic violence. Now, there wasn't any domestic violence in the relationship. However, Hannah did experience coercive control in the relationship. And 99% of domestic homicides are a result of coercive control. However, only 50% of domestic homicides were actually protected or attempted to be protected by a domestic violence order. In Australia, one woman is killed every 9 days and one man is killed every 29 days as a result of domestic violence. Internet partner violence is the leading cause for premature death, illness and disability in women aged 18 to 44 years of age. And children living with domestic violence are developing brains 20% smaller than their peers. This is why I've developed the Illuminate. The Illuminate is a beacon. It's a wearable device, it's not a tracker, so it won't enable technology-facilitated abuse. It will sense, alert, and transmit acute distress and when the user's experiencing a life-threatening event. It'll enable manual activation as well as disarm. The Illuminate should also help to prevent and deter offenders. It should enable swifter offender apprehension, and it should mitigate the physiological, psychological, and neurological effects of trauma. What I've done so far is I've spoken to over 66 end users and four customers who are looking after these users. So customers like the New South Wales Department of Communities and Justice, Queensland Department of Safety, Women's Safety, and the Department, Tasmanian Department for Children and Youth. Also, New South Wales Police Head of Work Health Safety would love to have their staff trial this as well. We're working on the intellectual property. We're building a first model of appointed design and industry to develop prototype. And we're just looking for research participants from other departments that could also participate in a pilot program and issue the initial prototype to their end users, so women at risk of domestic violence and their child protection caseworkers staff for Communities and Justice would also like to be wearing this. Department of Housing personnel. So if you can help me reach out to other people, I mean, Hannah's a caseworker in Queensland, she was head of women's safety in Queensland. She said if Hannah had this, she might still be here. So if you could help me reach more departmental managers who could, you know, get this device out to their customers, their clients, you know, get in touch, reach out to me, and we'll be able to issue it out and hopefully reduce the rate of domestic homicide in Australia and everywhere. Thank you.
Give it up, guys. Give it up. Come on.
Thank you.
Oh, look, Suzie, what you are doing is absolutely amazing. And honestly, you know, your passion and clearly your emotion for what you're doing is, you know, really has, you know, we're all affected by that. And I'm sure, you know, all of us have been affected at some stage by someone we've known or someone we've loved who's been, you know, impacted by domestic violence. And so I just, it's an incredible thing, an incredible journey that you're on. What, in terms of the funding for the product, are you looking to get government funding for this, or is this a user pays?
So I'm self-funding the prototype and the development of the prototype, and we would be issuing the devices to departmental managers, and they would be paying for a subscription. The device hopefully would be free, or like a $5 fee, and then they would be paying like a $5 or $25 per year for connectivity and upgrades and that sort of thing. So they would be issuing it to their customers. We've discovered a whole lot of other customer segments as well, and I believe there will be an option down the track for people to be able to buy it for themselves if their nurse is travelling to and from work. But at this stage, we're starting with those community services departments purchasing it for their customers, for their clients at high risk of homicide.
So you just totally reset the scale at which I would look at passion when people present their pitches. I really, really, really commend you on that. It's pretty touching, really. So it's amazing, and but it's also a little bit in your way, because I think we have to find a way to kind of talk about the proposition here as well. Yeah. So yeah. What I would like to hear from you now a little bit more is what is actually measured in what's the technological, okay. So what's the tech behind this invention that you have?
So the prototype's going to start with like basic off-the-shelf tech. So what we're hoping for is just a basic device that we could manually activate. It would ring the local tower or use Wi-Fi, whatever it can, to call for emergency services. It'll have a basic GPS that will only be activated, and it won't be a tracker, so it's just a beacon. It'll tell them the user's coordinates when they're in distress. What I would like for the device to do down the track as we do upgrades is for the device to be able to automatically sense and alert when the user are experiencing a life-threatening event. So their vitals might be failing, or they're experiencing a high acute level of stress hormones that's indicating that they're perceiving a life-threatening event. And then for the device to be able to automatically activate and send for help and transmit the user's coordinates. So that's down the track. I know there's different things that we can do to try and sense that the user's experiencing distress and improve those that tech as the tech becomes more available.
Brave. Two aspects here. One, in terms of, I think, let me start with, where are you stuck right now? What's holding you back? What are the things that are holding you back?
Oh, so it's just we're in the motion of getting the prototype put together, and then I'm just going to get my sales skills into gear and start getting it out and saying, hey, I've got a prototype here. Like just having the courage to pick up the phone and say, hey, Narelle, you know how I talked to you about, you know, that device that you'd like me to develop and try? I've got it ready. I'm really worried about going, oh, are you still interested? And just saying, yeah, how many do you want? And this is how much it's going to cost, asking for them to pay for the service, you know, or that's really what's going to be needing for me to develop in order to continue to go forward once design and industry have done their part in terms of developing the product, the initial prototype, getting it out there and trying to make enough money for us to be able to keep up the upgrades and keep the connectivity going.
All right, awesome. The second part is, can you bring this being device agnostic? Could it work on multiple devices that people already have?
And so I'm not interested in getting this device simulated with smart watches or other things like that can enable technology facilitated abuse. So these devices will be encrypted. They'll be anonymous. So anyone can just grab one and put it on. It's like one of your old phones that you would have, you know, been able to just call emergency services and no one will know who you are. So it's not something that I want a smartwatch to be able to just start doing, because perpetrators are using those technologies. They know who owns that watch, they know who owns that phone, and they're using that to stalk their victims, and they're actually leading victims to the perpetrators to the victims.
Well, that was interesting. Yeah, really, really interesting. Because I did think when you presented earlier, and I think you said it too, there was possibly other applications of that technology. What were you thinking of there?
So we have... I can move forward. I've got a few other slides. So we've got children at risk of significant harm as well. So we'd like to go through the ethics of getting children to wear this. But we also have the disability sector, aged care sector, emergency services personnel, who, other than the police. So we've got fireys who aren't always able to call for help because they might be out of radio frequency range, out of sight, out of sight, sound. We've got recreational enthusiasts as well who would like something like this, particularly if it provides a feature that if you're unable to get help, get connectivity with your traditional mobile phone towers and that sort of thing. And also the medical sector in terms of monitoring people with quite severe or acute medical conditions, outpatients, for example, who might need to call for help but they've suffered a medical episode unattended or, yeah.
Suzie, do you want to share what happened when you talked to one of those customers, like Narelle, for instance?
Yeah, so... A lot of the customers that I've spoken to have, you know, had real life experiences of, you know, where they would have wished something like this was already available because they've seen so many people be failed by the system. And the fact that, like I said, 50% of domestic homicides, the victim wasn't protected by a domestic violence order because they didn't realise that they were at risk of domestic homicide. They might have been experiencing coercive control. And had left the relationship because they're unhappy with not being able to see their family and friends as much as they wanted, as often as they wanted. But having left that relationship and having perpetrator lose control of them had actually put them at the highest risk of being a victim of domestic homicide.
And can you share with us how much they're willing to pay for a device like this?
So I'm hoping...
I know what she said.
Oh, yes. So she said she would pay up to $500 per device, that Narelle from Department of Women's Safety in Queensland, which we're not wanting to charge that much at all.
I just wanted to bring this into the picture. She actually got the customer to say her price and to say that she, like, that solution validated all the problems. I mean, in my book, you're that close to the sale now. All right. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thanks, guys.
All right, I think that's what I call, when you run your business, it's a passion, it's not a job, right? And that's what keeps you driving, that's what keeps you going, knocking at the door, talking to the customers, going through all those technical issues, that's your passion and it's worth it. And then when you know it's got an impact on people, it's just beautiful. I'd like to call our last FutureUp participant, Justin. Is Justin in the room? Yes.
Thanks, and thanks again, Suzie. That was great and has been in practice as well. But to sort of a little bit lighter in tone. Now, probably everyone in this room has consumed about 2 hours of user-generated video this week. And in fact, 20% of all video consumed, even including film and television, is user-generated. But that will be 50% in 3 years' time. So actually, who is actually going to need all this video? Well, if you think about Google, actually, there's 6 billion Google listings there that only have pictures. They need video. 620 million Facebook groups all need weekly video. And even if you think about just one e-commerce site alone, Amazon has 400 million product reviews, all need user-generated video. So why don't they have them? Well, because user-generated video is hard, right? So at the moment, you've basically got three options. You either have to run a contest, which is a huge ball ache, or you have to try to DM, you have to direct message Instagrammers, which is also really hard, and you have to negotiate fees. Or you pay influencers, and you end up with kind of generic-looking, pretty schmaltzy stuff, right? So we've spent 2 years basically solving this problem. We've built an entire ecosystem to enable you to both crowdsource and to use and to license content created by your superfans. To give you some examples here, we have either colleague generated. This is one of our customers, which is a travel agency using back in the COVID, before COVID, using its agents, its employees, to actually source the video for them and put them together into video travelogues. An online community using it to crowdsource beauty reviews, or even a hairdressing salon using it to get their customers to upload their pictures of their videos as they're actually having their hair done. So basically, how big is this market? Well, it's absolutely enormous. We did an enormous market research, and we focused on 5 industries, which together almost $160 billion available market. Now, basically, we're focusing on just one at the moment, publishing, including social media, which if we got 5% of the Australian market, that's $650 billion. We'll be happy with that. Do we have any competitors? Well, yes, but not who you think. So it's definitely not Zoom. There are some other people doing either crowdsourcing or templated video or dynamic video. Nobody is combining all three the same way we are, but there are people who could. So how do we make money? Well, basically, it's a B2B2C. Software as a service. It's free for small teams, and then a tiered subscription model depending on usage. So what traction do we have today? Well, we actually, during COVID, killed our app. But before we did, we had 7,500 app downloads. We've now moved to a browser-based approach. We've raised some money, $620,000, and we also won the pitch for $1 million, but that's been suspended because of COVID. But we're more excited about our customers. So City of Sydney, University of Sydney, Bass and Dean Paddlers over in WA, Community Group, Pupsy, which is a dog travel service, and SiteMinder, a hotel aggregator. So who is Vloggy? Well, basically the rule is you have to begin with Jay to be part of the core team. So Jürgen, Jeremy at the back and me, we did have more before COVID, but we're now sort of super lean. But we also have some great strategic advisors. Ian is in the room and maybe some others who are very, very active. So what do we need now? Well, we need mainly introductions. So we need some large scale players who need a huge amount of video. So before COVID, we were talking to people like trip.com, and they wanted to run a trial, and they wanted to have 46,000 videos per week produced. That's the kind of people we need to meet now who aren't in travel. We also are looking for investment, so we just closed a pre-seed round, and later on this year we'll be actually launching a seed round, $2.5 million, we're just working out the details, but also maybe some accelerators. We were in line to be in 4 accelerators this year, and we in fact right now should be in Tel Aviv, but we weren't because of COVID, so we're looking for more opportunities. If you know any of these, here are my details.
Unique concept, and it was exciting to see you because I heard about you guys a couple of weeks back on a pitch that was made using Vloggy. So yeah. You're there. Two aspects again. One, in terms of the reach, and you mentioned that you're looking for people who want to consume video. Who are the top 3 people that come to your mind?
Well, so when we look at our market segments, you know, the reason we looked at travel initially was because I'm from the travel industry, and also they had the biggest need, right? So their product is location, right? So that was the single biggest market. But travel industry is dead, for obvious reasons. So now, sort of media companies and any large marketing organizations which have a large audience base. So basically, our technology sits in the middle, but we need companies that already have a reach to their audience, already have a community, who have a way of engaging them, and our technology just sits in the middle. We're not a two-sided marketplace. We're not about getting contributors and customers. We're only about getting customers, and we give them the technology for them to produce content.
Awesome. Sorry. Second part, in terms of storage of content, is that labeled? How is that stored, and is it reusable?
Yeah, so every bit of some of the patentable IP that's in the middle of this is actually every bit of video that comes in has about 32 different data points, and the ultimate goal is actually to completely automate video production. Okay, so what you're seeing here is just the beginning. What we really want to do is produce completely automated video production, and we can only do that by each 10 or 15 second snippet that comes in. We wrap around 32 different data points, and we will be able to produce in 2 or 3 years' time. If you said, produce me a highlights video of the best pitch nights at Fishburners, bam, we should be able to do that because we have enough data in there.
So this is an AI capability that you're developing, is that correct?
Eventually, yes. So what we've done so far is only about 5% of the total vision. But yes, totally automated via machine learning and AI.
And what's your experience with that?
Well, we have built some prototypes within this system, but limited. So basically, part of what we're raising money for is to hire some more tech heads, one of which will be in the machine learning, another will be in visual templating. But then we also, half of the money we're raising is actually marketing. Like, so we actually need to push this product out to many different markets very quickly.
So you might be chasing different customers now as you will be chasing a year from now or 2 years from now?
Yeah, look, ultimately this is a solution for, this will, professional looking user generated video will completely disrupt the video production industry. Okay, so in 2 or 3 years' time, we will replace video production and TV shops. There will be entire TV series made in this sort of technology, is my goal. So yes, and for now, we're targeting small businesses and marketing managers of medium-sized businesses. Yeah. But in 2 or 3 years' time, we'll have entire sort of Netflix channels made in this method. Maybe 5 years' time.
All right, I've got a selfish question, Justin. Could you share what was your experience working with Shun, working with Suzie, with Simon, who were very at the early stage, and you had the experience. What did you get from the program?
FutureUp was actually really good because it happened at the same time as COVID. So basically, as I've said, you know, we had built this product specifically for the travel and tourism industry with some events. In fact, I can see some people in the room who actually took part in an earlier demo with the City of Sydney around events. So events and travel and tourism was who we were focusing at. And then COVID happened and the whole industry died. So actually, I was able to use all of the tools that everyone else did for earlier stage startups to actually revalidate the product and turn it from a vertical led product to a very horizontal led. In fact, those words are Jeremy's, who's at the back of the room. He said, we need to be horizontal, not vertical. And that's kind of where we are now. Anybody can use this for any application. No, that's the fourth pitch. The surprise pitch.
Oh, there's a surprise pitch. Okay.
Maybe I've ruined the surprise. yeah, that's mine, Nicole. Yeah. Oh, you didn't mention my shoes.
Your experience and knowledge that I've certainly benefited from that as well.
Thank you, and thank you. Thank you, Fishburners.
Is there a question?
Yeah, no, we definitely are looking for an API version. In fact, we actually have a letter of intent with a company called Party Flick, which actually wants to crowdsource wedding reception videos, right? But this was also great, and we were going to actually dedicate some resources to doing that, but then wedding industry died, right? So, but yes, yeah, definitely. So basically, what you have, what we are doing now is a self-service tool, but ultimately, this can be replicated, you know, 1,000 times in different verticals. And we're going to let other people actually market and sell to other verticals, and the self-service tool will be ours. So yes, definitely.
Just a final word for me, I think. Just, I'm only slowly just starting to understand the dimensions and the sort of the idea that you're having there. It's I think it's big.
Totally changing the whole world.
I have one application after the other. It ticks from my head. Yeah, that too, and that you could do this too. So it's pretty amazing. So congratulations, and also on that great pitch.
Thank you.
So I use the image of that massive swell that comes in a wave, and that's what happened to Justin. He was like, gang on, tourism, and then the wave came, no more tourism. And then he goes, yes, events, no more events. And it's like, this is where you've got your tools, this is where you've got your entrepreneurial mindset, your entrepreneurial competencies to go and pivot and to go back to it and build again. And it's hard from a pitch to realize what the product is, but for me, it was really cool to actually use it. I got each of my participants to record their elevator pitch. You know that 30 seconds elevator pitch? They recorded 3 clips of 10 seconds on their phone. They uploaded that to the platform on their own. All I had to do was go, oh, I'll just take this one together, click the button, and add a video. So out of those 9 videos, I was able to do 12 promo videos that you'll find on my LinkedIn profile. And it was like, it made my life so much easier. And I think all, you know, startup competition, pitching competition, just having that tool that is like so convenient to start all those promo clips on social media. Did you guys see the traction? Like $650,000 raised, more than 7,500 downloads. I mean, those are crazy numbers. This is like type of numbers that we want to be proud of. And so I just wanted to thank Justin and to say, man, I just want to see the next 6 months where you go. So thank you, Justin. So while everybody go and vote on, what is it again? Slido, we're going to have a surprise pitch. Oh, and I'll just do a promo for July and August if you want to book an event for his Fishburners. You've got 20% discount, and it's got amazing filming capability. We're going stream live right now. I mean, this is the best. And did I mention they open while everyone else is closed? I mean, this is awesome. So if you want to participate in the next cohort of FutureUp, go on the Fishburners website and register your interest. That's simple as that. Who is the next person who wants to pitch? If you're not coming, I'll take the scooter with me.
G'day, everybody. My name's James. I found out that this was happening maybe 5 or 10 minutes before I arrived. So I'm sorry it's not as well lubed as these guys were. There is something coming. Yeah, man, have we got my... No, it's not on here.
Look, the slide open. Everyone got the number.
That's it. Okay, I'll be really quick. My name's James. My company's name is Eat My Dust Scooters, and that explains why this is sitting here. Some shameless promotion of the product. What we do is we're in the business of electric motorbikes, and as hard as businesses have been hit by COVID, COVID's actually been quite good for us. Because nobody's in any mad rush to jump on a bus to work, right? So what we do is we provide these through wholesale channels and retail channels, and they're $3,000. It'll get you from anywhere within, say, 5 or 10 kilometres of the city to work 100% electric, sustainable, and our mission is to change the way people get to work. That's it. That's me.
Hang on. You're not done, James. You're not done.
Oh, good.
So you don't get off this stage without a comment. So these are motorbikes. These are not bicycles, right?
That's correct. They're registered on the road.
So you need to have a motorcycle license to ride them?
Yeah, that's an interesting point. Thanks for such a leading question. Because in Queensland, South Australia and WA, you don't need a license to ride them. In New South Wales and Victoria, you do. So where everybody lives, you do need one, yes.
That's right. So how does that limit your ability to get into this market? Because you're obviously looking for new customers and not for already existing motorcycle riders. Because if I want this here tomorrow, I have to get my license first.
That's right, yeah. So for a long time, and it's going to be something we do through Fishburners as well, we actually pay for people to go and get their license. So for $3,000, look, before I go into that, the whole idea is it's jaw-droppingly cheap. Is like that's the mission statement, right? So it's $3,000 delivered, registered for a year, and we'll throw in your license as well.
And you own it at that price.
And you own it forever.
I have an electric. So I have an electric bike, and that's $6,000. But
yeah. So my, you'll get about 80 kilometres out of a single charge. From 0% to 100 is about 6 hours. Any wall outlet? Yep, the battery just pops out and you plug it into the wall. This took. This is the third iteration. It took about 3 years of design to get here. No, we don't. We manufacture them in China, but we design them. Say that again, sorry? You'll get 80 kilometres out of a single charge cycles. Oh, you'll get 3,000 charge cycles. So if you charged it every day for 9 years.
Can I ask more?
This,
which this, color?
You'd be surprised how often this happens. This is the biggest challenge of the business, is getting people on them. Once you ride it, it's so fun. It's, yeah, that's right. You can take it. You can. Well, would you like to work for Eat My Dust Scooters? You're doing such a good job. Wow, what a night. Sorry, all did right. That answer your question?
One more question.
Sorry. Yeah, g'day.
At the back.
Yeah, thanks for your question. We have, yeah. So imagine Thailand, Vietnam, places like that are enormous, you know, they adopt this style of transport so quickly. Unfortunately, they're relatively saturated. There's a company called Gogoro who make an amazing product, and in Australia, they can't get it compliant. So that's what gives us a lot of runway here. But absolutely, in the future, as the technology gets better, our blue ocean is, you know, those really densely populated cities sustainably.
And we have one more question at the back.
Yeah. So any metered parking zone, you can park for free. So I, right before I was bringing it up here, I was parked just at the church up there. So anywhere you see 1p ticket, 4p ticket, anything like that, you can park this there for free for that same period. Well, this young lady over here is going to have hers tomorrow morning. We hold the stock here. So That's one of the biggest needs, cash intensive parts of the business is we buy the stock, we hold it here, and the fastest delivery we once did was 3 hours. Warranty is, it varies on parts, so the motor's made by Bosch, so that's a lifetime warranty, and on degradable parts it's 12 months, and structural parts it's 2 years.
All right, thank you so much. Okay, who else wants to come on stage and do a quick elevator pitch? You can introduce what you're doing at Fishburners. Yeah, come on. Just 30 seconds, just to, you know, get the experience to be up here on stage, talk about what you're doing. In the meantime, continue voting. We've got quite a few votes already through, and it's neck and neck, so your vote might make the difference. What's your name?
Ali.
Ali.
Thank you. I just got here, so I'm kind of trying to figure out what I wasn't expecting to go for a hi. I wasn't expecting to do this pitch, but Selicom is my startup, and it's a gift registry for special occasions. So how it works is that you put any dates there, obviously, and it could be your dog's birthday, it could be your birthday, anyone else's birthday that you may wish your employees. And you can share it, it gives you a QR code and you can share it on social media, and people can buy gifts for that person. So how it works, the recipient can receive, can choose what they want, and all the gifts will be wrapped the way the giver gives and will be shipped to their recipient on the day of their, you know, occasions. So that's we've got the MVP now.
And how can we reach you?
So if I've got the, I can give you my
to everyone.
Yeah. So my email is ali@selicom.net, and the yeah, you can just but we're raising seed rounds, so it's, you know, it's a perfect time. You can add me to your LinkedIn. I can somehow write my name somewhere.
So if anybody wants to get in touch with Ali, I recommend to come and talk to him after this pitch.
Yes.
Thank you so much,
You're
Ali.
You're welcome. Thanks for that. Thanks for having me.
All right, we still have more votes coming in. Who wants to come here? Okay, come on, come here. This is fun, guys. This is a safe place where you can get to talk and get the experience of the light.
Thank you.
So, what's your name?
All right, my name is Jake. I am a founder of Sheps.care.com. Sheps.care.com is a registered national disability insurance scheme. I have created a program for people with disability in Australia. It's called Adaptive Cooking Class. It's been done last year. Adaptive cooking class is not like a normal cooking class. Adaptive cooking class is like this. All right, this is a knife. All right, I'm gonna slice this meat. I'm gonna do 1, 2, 3. You wanna try that? Okay, 1, 2, 3. Excellent, that was really great. You did a fantastic job. Even though I am a qualified chef, 80% of what I do with people with disability is all about cheerleading, motivation, and like, you did a great job, and that's what they want. Unfortunately, I am fully booked every day. In fact, I just had 6 cooking class today. My cooking program is under the policies of National Disability Insurance Scheme. So I created a program that would fit into the safety features of the people with disability. Money-wise, it's really good because we are guided by the NDI Spicing Guides. Right now, what I'm doing is I'm looking for people who got the heart, who have with the same passion of what I do. So I'm looking for parents, teachers, volunteers to help me out. Just do the program. And the reason why I'm here, because I'm looking for funds to do it. I don't have the money to, the program is already done. All I need is money so that we can set up a community where I could train everyone. And you don't have to worry about the market. Because let's say if you live down in Gladesville, you already got 200 people living with disability already wanting to do the cooking class for you. And remember, this is an adaptive cooking class. It's already a program. Thank you.
How can we reach you?
Chefs.care.com.
Thank you so much. Can we talk afterwards? Because this hit close to home. My daughter has cerebral palsy, and this morning we were making eggs, and she can't use her right hand. So you have to figure out how to mix everything, and it's so challenging. But she has so much fun. Like, you know, when she puts the eggs on the table and she says to mom, "I made this," and it's like, wow, exactly. And the beauty with this is, if it's under NDIS, and for all entrepreneurs here who wants to do business for people with disability, as soon as you're approved by NDIS, as people with disability, we have a budget for the year and we can spend with you. And so it gets straight from the government to the entrepreneur. So it's a great market over there. Cool. All right. So before I go with the winner from the audience, I think the supporting panel couldn't help themselves. Do you guys want to share what you wanted to do?
Sorry, I think it's, you know, it's too difficult to pick one individual, and so we've selected everybody as our winners this evening. And so there will all be, everyone will be getting an additional month membership at Fishburners. So. Woo!
Yeah, in response to Nicole, any of the three or four of you want to have a one-to-one session, I'm happy to help and spend an hour or two with you guys.
Woo! Thank you.
Well done. Big congratulations to everyone who pitched tonight, including the stand-up pitchers who just came in briefly. An amazing night, really. I'm really impressed, and I'm very, very proud to be part of this. Thank you.
All right. So, and the audience here voted. Sorry, there's still more votes coming in, and it's and so the audience has voted for, where is Justin! And so, Justin, it feels like you're going to be stuck at Fishburners because you get more. So I just want to say that having an extra month at Fishburners for the team, it's really, really valuable because they got three through the program. Now that's another fourth month. So they can start, they can continue building relationship with all the startups in the business here and keep going to the next step. So thank you very much, Nicole. That's very much appreciated. And now let's go and talk to the founders. Now you've heard the pitch. Now you can go and talk to them. And please come back to the next event. Thank you so much.